Welcome to our March offering of Lunch and Learn. We'll begin in prayer, and then we will move on to hearing from our guest speaker today. The prayer is prayer to Our Lady of Guadalupe for justice. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most merciful Mother, you came to tell us of your compassion through St. Juan Diego, whom you called the littlest and dearest of your sons. Give your strength and protection to all who live in poverty today, especially the young, elderly, and vulnerable. Plead for them to the Father that they might experience the divine love tangibly in their lives, and that all who work for justice on behalf of the poor might grow in fortitude and humility. In these ways, manifest your charity and concern in our lives, that the weeping of humanity may be heard, and all our suffering, pain, and misfortune may be filled with divine comfort and healing. May we always know the peace of being in the cradle of your arms, and bring us safely home to your Son, Jesus. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Because of work schedules or class schedules, the first part of our Lunch and Learn is actually a recorded conversation I had, and I believe that rather than me repeating who it is and under what circumstances, I'm merely going to share the video of that recording with you now. For today's Lunch and Learn, we have a recorded interview here, a recorded conversation with Catholic Campaign Human Development intern Julissa Govia. Julissa is a sophomore at the University of Iowa, majoring in political science and pre-law. Julissa has been the CCHD intern since August, and we wanted to make sure that we took this opportunity here in March to be able to hear from Julissa, knowing that academic calendars and schedules get busy. Without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Julissa. Welcome, Julissa.
Hello, thank you for the introduction. So yeah, hello, good afternoon. I'm Julissa Govea, an intern for the Catholic Campaign for Human Development. I'll be saying CCHD for short. And I'm glad to give this talk and share my experience about my internship and how this has impacted what I have learned along the way and how I transcend my own conviction to God by following this path of action for greater impact in the community. And so let me begin with what is CCHD. So this is an anti-poverty and social justice program of the United States of Conference of Catholic Bishops. And this program strives to make a change in structures and communities that need it. And by making this change, it is provided out of the love of God, and by this making transformations that create opportunities for others. And so then my mission as a CCHD intern is to carry out my service through this in the community by outreach, relationships with community leaders, and to reflect on the Catholic social teaching. And so let me move on to tell you a little bit about what the Center for Worker Justice is. And this is where I carry out my internship as a community organizer, helping with wage theft cases that occur in the community, and what I have learned, what it means to advocate for social justice awareness and how it can be done through faith, love, and action. And so about the center, it is an immigrant-founded organization that brought the community together to be able to address issues that affect their own communities. It was founded in 2012, and ever since strives to mitigate issues in the communities and achieve social justice in a place that empowers and educates people that walk through our doors to form a sense of solidarity, and because we like to let everybody know that we are all one team. And here I provided some CWJ victories that I thought were interesting for you to know. And so that since 2012, it has recovered over $200,000 in wage theft. It also passed one of the first community ID programs in the Midwest, helped raise minimum wage in Johnson County to $10.10, Even though the state blocked this ruling, CWJ still encouraged local businesses to pay this wage, and over 170 businesses committed to pay this minimum wage, and also strive in helping with affordable housing and with a specific program called My Home to Yours. This program had $500,000 in donations and provided support to over 700 families during the COVID-19 pandemic. And so these were a lot of huge achievements that CWJ does to help with issues. And I would like to dive in more now that I have introduced where I carry out my service as an intern about the 2 feet of love in action, because I really love this diagram. And I think it's really important because it had also taught me the importance of social justice and the work of charitable works as in to fulfill this obligation of justice and charity. And well, I believe you're all now familiar with this. And so obviously social justice focusing more on improving structures that includes like supporting laws, education rights, and et cetera, and charitable works meeting more the needs of individuals by providing aids to them, which can include homeless shelters, giving food and with education and those types of assistance. And I really do appreciate this diagram because it really represents the type of action and missions for us as Catholic disciples to show God's love and conviction. And well, this comes from like Pope Benedict XVI that describes the bond of love between God and our neighbor, which I thought was really important. And also Pope Francis stating that not just a prayer will lead you to practical action for your neighbor. And Pope Benedict XVI again stating how it is a primary way of charity. And to elaborate more on that, being the root cause of the problems that face the community, which is what I got out from it. And so by doing so, advocating for public policies and changing social structures for the better, and by supporting low income and making an impact to transform those communities. So I feel like this diagram really shows and demonstrates that type of advocating for social justice awareness that I have learned throughout my internship. And so then these two are different ways to grow spiritually by walking in God's path by taking that sort of action. And moving on to the CCHD, Catholic social teaching is also a second point that I would really like to emphasize, because for instance, I'll be going through each of the points and how each one has really related to the social justice advocating that I have been doing in my internship that I believe has been very important. And for instance, the life and dignity of the human person is to strengthen the life and dignity of that individual. And this is something important that I would like to really emphasize because of the experience I have, where many individuals walk in to the Center for Worker Justice that seek guidance with their specific issues. And we would like to use this as an opportunity to teach those people to value themselves and teach them their rights and to resolve issues as a team through peace, so they will be intact with their own dignity and spread that to others. And the second point, call to family, community, and participation, is another point that I would really love to emphasize because it is a way of how we organize our community to grow, and by that we collectively participate in important issues that affect the community. And this is a type of work that is really focused on in my internship, where we let people know that walk through our doors that we are not here just to help, but we are here to empower one another and educate them through their issues, and from there form a community to help each other out. And so by that, we try to invite people to participate in community issues and learn from there. And with the third one, rights and responsibility, I feel like can dive into each point because through that, it is believed that dignity and a good community can be achieved if the rights of people are protected, but through that comes huge responsibility. And this really relates to the importance of aiming to find the root cause and what it is what we try to do when helping people with housing issues, wage theft cases, and even trying to avoid and support laws from passing that are not beneficial to communities and low-income communities as well. And so moving on to the fourth one, option for the poor and vulnerable. In this point, helping people in need first is very important because not only should we help the ones in much need, but it is also important to understand them and their communities to do so, which is something that we do as a nonprofit organization. And to moving on the fifth point, the dignity of work and the rights of workers. It is very important to protect the dignity of the worker and to protect the basic rights of workers and for it to be respected. And this is exactly what I have been doing in my time as an intern, where I strive to help protect the rights of workers and have it be respected, because like every person here works to make a living, it is only fair for them to be treated fairly. And the sixth point is one of my favorite ones, because this is how we should be with one another. As brothers and sisters, a family that unites where differences do not matter. And by doing this, we are able to combat injustices together, because if you think about it, this is how many justices are achieved, through collective action. And it is a beautiful and impressive thing when people unite to do this together. And in the seventh point, care for God's creation. And by combating these injustices, we are showing our respect to our God by protecting one another through our faith. And there are many obstacles and challenges that communities face where we are called through duty and faith. So I really do believe that through the Catholic social teaching, I have learned and also helped guide a lot of people that have come in or have encountered through my internship, how social justice and the Catholic faith do intersect in advocating for these awareness in the communities. And so then diving more specifically, I have mentioned wage theft a lot. This is what I do as a community organizer throughout my internship, and also as outreaching with community leaders. I have really learned how to identify wage theft cases and help individuals out in my internship. So I created this diagram that shows what wage theft is, the consequences, and who the victims are. And so starting off with a simple question, what is wage theft? So it is when employers do not pay the worker for the hours they worked, low salary payments, not abiding to law and regulations, and misclassification towards workers. And these are sort of the basic general identifications that you would often hear or see. And the consequences are that families are not able to pay their expenses or provide for their own families, and the community is affected as well, because if one worker is affected, usually there's another and another, and it's a continuous cycle that occurs. And the victims are the families, the community as a whole, and the workers themselves. And so there is also a specific process that I have learned where it involves an intake form, a phone call, a letter, delegation, and protest. So these are ways that we try to combat this issue by getting to know the person, by taking their intake, hearing their story, guiding them, and learning more about the individual first. And then we go into a phone call to try to recover the wages stolen from those individuals. And if that doesn't work, we send a letter letting those people know that it is a violation, that it is illegal what they're doing, but trying to take things calm, because we're trying to do this in a peaceful manner. And if that doesn't work out, it is important, because I have learned that outreach and reaching out to people in the community, we can go to what is called a delegation process, where we have, like, for instance, the city council representatives, we have church leaders, we have a lot of important community leaders come and let the employer know that what they're doing, it is illegal, and that we are by the person who is affected, and that they are not alone, and that the community is there to back them up. And if it has to go further, we do a friendly protest outside of the work facility to let others also be aware of the type of crime that is happening in the community. So this is a wage theft process that we have to go through to help the individual. And I would like to share quickly about three cases, just briefly, because if we get into details, I mean, there's a lot. But I won't name the person's names, but these are three cases that I have encountered and noticed specific patterns as well. For example, overtime, incomplete checks, and a lot of cleaning companies and those types of services are where I see that is most affected, and in construction as well. So with the first person, this person came in not knowing about how they just noticed that they weren't paid for the amount of hours they worked, but they didn't know that wage step was something that was illegal or even a violation to their right for them not to be being paid their wages. So that is the opportunity that we also take to empower and educate those people so they could also let others in the work facility be aware of what's going on. And so this person was not paid their overtime and was working 65 hours a week, which is a lot. And so we help recover that person's money by going through the wage theft process that I had explained earlier. So overtime wages that are not paid is something that I currently see. And also cleaning company and services also take advantage where it's overtime and incomplete checks. And we did help recover money for this cleaning company service just about a week ago. And then we recovered $750 for four individuals each. And so that was a great achievement. We were happy to help those people out. And so then they also become members of the community, and they also strive to help advocate for this awareness. And so then the third person that I noticed came in and they were being paid, underpaid in their checks, and they were supposed to be paid $20 an hour, but were actually getting paid around $14 and $15 an hour. And they didn't notice that until 2 weeks in working in their job. And so then they came in and we went through the same process and help recover their money too for, I think, the 2 months that they were not getting paid for their incomplete checks. And so then this is something that I have noticed where overtime wages are not paid. A lot of people are getting exploited, like in cleaning companies and stuff collectively. And also incomplete checks are a huge pattern that I see and I notice. And so then I would like to emphasize three main points that I have found very important by advocating in this social justice awareness is the number one thing, forming solidarity. I believe it is very important because without one another, without this collective action and this this family that we form, it is very hard to try to achieve this justice and try to create this environment to help one another. And so I believe it is very important because with that we can achieve big things and make an impact in the community. And by that, we also have to flourish lives in dignity by helping empower one another, and through that promoting peace and reconciliation as well, because there are ways to resolve issues in the community through peace, and also teaching others that violence is not always the answer, and to do things calm and through all of the points that I've stated earlier. And also to end things off, I provided this quote here that says, "To all people of goodwill who are working for social justice, never tire of working for a more just world marked by greater solidarity," which I believe is very important because big accomplishments and huge achievements are usually achieved through solidarity. Yes. So thank you. And that is all.
Julissa, thank you so much for the presentation and a glimpse into the internship that you've had. Though we're recording this and you will not be able to necessarily field questions from the audience that will see this on Thursday, I do have a couple of questions I'd like to be able to ask you. Mm-hmm. One of them is, what was the response when you have helped somebody obtain the wages that they had been promised? What's their response when they're able to actually get what they had been promised?
Well, honestly, I am very astonished because these people have been so grateful, and because they also get to see the action in person. Because, like how I mentioned before, we are not there to just let them know that, oh, we are here to help and put them off to the side. No, we are working as a team. So they are also part of the process in the action.
Right.
And so then once they see that, they're like astonished as well, because they would never notice that all of these community leaders that are willing to work with them, all of the people at the Center for Worker Justice, and even the community members that have gone through the same situation are there to help throughout the process. So once they actually recover the money, they are astonished by this social justice work that they see. And so then they also want to become a member and say that they want to help someone else that has been in their position. So I think that's really amazing how it does really make an impact on individuals, and how that really motivates them to want to help someone else that has been in their place.
Another question is, did you have any sense as to all that you were going to learn? Did you have any idea as you began your academic year, did you have any sense that it would be as involved, as informative as you've just described? Did you anticipate this being what you would experience?
Honestly, I didn't. I thought I was going to be more like following someone in the office and learning more like that. But honestly, I have been open to many experiences, as in also training, getting to go to events in person, meeting great community leaders, hearing talks, and getting to, yeah, just encounter great individuals who have taught me all of this. And honestly, there's a lot of hands-on work, a lot of action taking, and there's obviously a lot of like great opportunities that I have been a part of, and I'm glad that I have learned all of this, because I would have never thought that it would have been that I it would have felt this amazing to be part of a great team.
Another question I have is, you mentioned that you're a political science and pre-law major. How has this experience impacted what you're anticipating for your career?
It has made a huge impact, because not only was I interested in, like I was aiming towards working on more like immigration law after college, and this has also introduced me to a lot of that, but also I am really interested in like a lot of labor rights and rights for individuals. So that has really opened up many doors, as in the training and the experiences that I have had, as in not only to help out people in the community by volunteering in that organization, but to also want to study more human rights, labor laws, and immigration rights, to also come back and help these people with the same thing. So it has really changed my perspective on how much more I want to learn in the future.
Excellent. One last question, and this is probably what you had learned in training when you went to participated in national training for the Catholic Campaign for Human Development. But the work that CWJ undertakes is supported by way of generous Catholics contributing to the annual collection. And in fact, the paid internship that you have been part of was also as a result of the generosity of Catholics across the country who've contributed to the CCHD collection. Though this is March, we may very well use a portion of your presentation to promote the collection in November. What would you say to people, the Catholic faithful, as it relates to the CCHD collection, in order to encourage them to consider this collection as well?
I will say that it has been a great opportunity, and I'm very grateful to have been an intern for the CCHD program. And I believe that it would also make a huge impact on another individual for another future intern. and that they learn a lot, not only social justice awareness, but to also make an impact in their communities. And if that could be also taught and learned through a different person, that'll just keep on building up the chain on making impacts in communities, and to also keep that going on for future interns. And I believe that it is a great opportunity that everyone needs to experience and also feel this change and motivation to strive to make a more just world.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time. I'm thanking you also on behalf of those that will watch this. You have the rest of the semester yet with the internship. We will provide people a way to contact you if they have particular questions or wish to say thank you, so that you'll get the feedback, even though this part of the session is being recorded. So again, like on behalf of everybody in the diocese, Julissa, thank you both for your willingness to say yes to the internship and your presentation today.
Thank you so much.
Wow, that's amazing.
At this time, what I'm going to do is also give some updates regarding the CCHD-funded groups in our diocese. And then following that, if there's questions or comments, I'd be willing to take those. So one moment while I do another screen share. Besides Julissa's sharing of her experience as a CCHD intern at the Center for Worker Justice, at their board meeting last night, there were some updates, and they were providing information from their social enterprise committee that's received two requests for catering of meals for two community meetings in Iowa City. At the CWJ board meeting, they were also talking about the Outreach and Engagement Committee that hopes to reactivate efforts to expand affiliate organizations, as well as expanding individuals and institutional members. There's also plans for what they refer to as two big table events planned for March with St. Andrew Church there in Iowa City. Of additional interest was the update from Stepping Up to Build Iowa's Future. 20 young construction workers from unions and CWJ have held training sessions in January and February, with upcoming meetings in March and April. They're also taking action to promote stronger labor standards in Coralville and Iowa City. And Eamon, the CWJ's executive director and laborers union leader, are representing this project in Washington, D.C. Additionally, CWJ has hired a full-time community organizer focusing on the construction industry. They've also hired an interim part-time grant writer. Both hires occurred during March. Escucha Mi Voz, the other local and national CCHD-funded group in our diocese, has also been active this year. As was reported in the February 22nd issue of the Catholic Messenger, following an Iowa Catholic Worker House Mass and Supper on February 16th, members of Escucha Mi Voz shared concerns about anti-immigrant bills that were being introduced at the Capitol in Des Moines. Members shared their personal migration stories, and the group began to plan next steps in response to some of the proposed legislation. On a weekend in early February, Escucha Mi Voz gathered for training on how to prepare for legislative visits. By way of the relationships that had been established, Escucha Mi Voz was actually being afforded an opportunity to testify in front of the Iowa Legislators International Relations Committee about the connection between international war and conflict in the Iowa economy. As reported in the Messenger, the visit to the Capitol and testimony was given on February 12th. 30 immigrant and refugee workers, accompanied by four members of the clergy from our diocese, attended. I was actually one of those that attended. It was a powerful expression of their name, Escucha Mi Voz, as workers had their voices heard by elected officials. Some bills of concern have progressed through the chambers at the Capitol, and Escucha Mi Voz has scheduled meetings to continue work on these issues this weekend in Iowa City and in West Liberty. Additionally, leaders of Escucha Mi Voz attended national advanced leadership training through Gamaliel Network in Nashville a week ago. In addition to the Center for Worker Justice of Eastern Iowa and Escucha Mi Voz that are presently receiving both local and national CCHD grant funds, Quad Cities Interface is also receiving local CCHD grant funds at this time. Earlier today, Acting Executive Director for QCI, Myra Hernandez, shared with me updates on several projects. In late February, QCI began what they refer to as a ROC campaign, which brings together leaders from different congregations to have intentional conversations with their fellow members about issues that they see as pressing. 40 attended from 10 different congregations. The ROC campaign will continue and include a late May issues assembly, where those from the different houses of worship come together to narrow down the list of issues to a few that all can agree to work on. Myra also shared that the tenants of Jackson Renaissance Apartments had achieved success in organizing, as their intercom system that had been in disrepair for years was now being fixed. The Organized Tenants Association met with a representative from the Iowa Finance Authority, and that relationship and other organizing efforts led to the intercom repairs and the landlord now being willing to meet with them on other matters of concern. Myra also provided an update on QCI's campaign to have community IDs. She shared that Moline has approved a community ID and is now moving to implementation, and that a meeting with Davenport Police and Fire Chiefs is scheduled for tonight. Myra also shared that St. Anthony Parish Youth also presented on the community IDs to a Quad City labor group, and that those in attendance were impressed with the youth's knowledge of the issues. Regarding leadership development, Myra added that the youth had also attended power one-on-ones with elected officials. Myra also shared that QCI has hired a St. Ambrose University student as an integrated voter intern, someone who can focus on areas with lower voter turnout and who also have ongoing issues relating to safe and affordable housing as matters that they concern themselves with. So it's the opportunity to hear from the student intern as well as to get the update on the CCHD funded groups gave our office the opportunity to get updates from those in order to share with all of you as Julissa did. Before I go to questions and comments on the topic of the day, I do want to make a program announcement. The April Lunch and Learn will actually be on the first Friday of April 5th at noon in order to accommodate the schedule of our guest presenter that day, Professor Dennis Teresi, Associate Professor and Chair of the Biology Department at St. Ambrose University. Dennis comes highly recommended by members of our office who've heard him speak on matters relating to care for creation and the climate crisis. And so we look forward to hearing from Dennis in April, but on the first Friday, not the first Thursday. At that, I'm going to stop talking, take a quick look at chat, and Just note for a second before other questions and fielding, Glenn Leach writes, under U.S. labor law, immigration status is not an issue. An employer must be paid the agreed upon wages in a timely manner. Lindsay Steele, friend of the office and of CCHD and the interns, speaks about her years of experience having done so, and as well as appreciating the impact those experiences have had. And then finally, shout out from Barb, also with the messenger, on the account given by Julissa. So I'm going to stop talking and allow people to have questions or comments. And if not, that's okay. It's good too. I hope to be able to have some assistance with editing, because I was really impressed with the extent to which Julissa understood both the internship as well as the bigger picture for the Catholic Campaign for Human Development. CCHD nationally is celebrating an anniversary in 2024, and the Bishops' Conference will look to dioceses that have had a long history of support of CCHD in order that the years to come will be as strong for people living and working in poverty as our history has had. And is it was interesting too, because the 2 feet of love and action, which the Bishops' Conference references, originated here with our own Monsignor Maudit. And so, Loxi, I think you got your hand raised, but you may need to unmute yourself. Oh, no, you're unmuted. Oh,
yeah, I wanted to, am I still muted or not?
No, you're good.
Okay. I wanted to mention that we're actually preparing to look for a new CCHD intern for the next year to serve either one of the organizations in Iowa City or one here in Davenport, depending on where the intern comes from. And we have had interns that are just done marvelous things. Myra was a Center for Worker Justice intern at one point. Rachel was with Quad Cities Interfaith, and she left there and went to organize with some Franciscan sisters, wasn't it,
right,
on the East Coast, and was discerning becoming a sister herself. She is an associate, but made a decision not to enter the order. However, she's in the process of discerning what her life's going to look like. And I just feel sure it's going to be something amazingly good for all of us, because she is a really amazing person. I can't think of one intern we've had that we really think was a dud, and we've had interns for absolutely years. I mean, it's fascinating to see what these young people contribute after their internships. And so I would encourage any of you that know young people, they must be Catholic and over 18. I generally think, Julissa was a sophomore. Usually I think juniors and seniors are more mature and ready for it, but I hope that you're able to think of someone that you think would be a good intern.
Joe, go ahead. Ray, you have to unmute yourself first.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yep.
I appreciate that. And where do I find that information? Is that on the diocese webpage or?
Right. Yeah. Under the diocese, if you go to the social action office, there'll be a menu on the left under CCHD. And to give the news, thank you, Loxi, for reminding me. We learned only earlier this week that we'd been afforded internship again. It's an incredible experience. If the really challenging situation is where you've got really interesting young adults that want to connect their faith with what they may be looking at for a career or practice of study, we always try to have the follow-up with those even that were not accepted as the one intern. But it's yeah, they're a talented bunch of folks.
Kent, I had a follow-on to that, and thank you for that information. She referenced a lot in terms of social justice initiatives, but there was not much in terms of charitable works. I'm sure that's another element in the program.
It is. Well, I mean, what I should say is Catholic Campaign for Human Development focuses on the one foot mostly. But I'll tell you that when she referenced the amount of financial support that the community gave for folks during the pandemic, that to me is the example of where when it got to a crisis point, everybody realizes that if you have somebody who does not have food, or they don't have housing, you're clearly looking at that in the immediate moment. But the response for the systemic change and empowering those that have been victims of wage theft, as an example, to in turn be the ones to help redress wrongs with those that are following them, that is profoundly other-footedness. And so it is as a result of the immediate needs and response to that other foot says, no, wait a minute, what else do we need to be looking at so that this is not just repeated on end? So, and Glenn, you were going to chime in?
Thank you.
Yeah. No? Okay. Sorry.
No, I was just going to say at the very beginning of her presentation, where she showed the 2 feet, she illustrated that the immediate needs of people must always be met.
Right.
But she also said that, feeding the hungry doesn't answer the question of why are they hungry.
And Dan, who lives in Iowa City, the Iowa City Metro, heavily involved with CWJ from the get-go. Dan, you can also attest to the fact that CWJ knows of the community resources that speak to those ongoing needs. Would that be an accurate thing to say?
Yes, CWJ is all hands on deck in the case of a crisis, and that was the case for the COVID crisis. They provide translation services, and those were urgently in need at some point, at several points in the course of the pandemic. There was also that huge outpouring of friends and allies from the Center for Worker Justice, who gave of themselves. Hundreds of thousands of dollars were just given to CWJ to distribute as they saw fit to the people who were most in need. And these were people who were having trouble with their utilities and their food and their housing. And lots of people were processed through CWJ who couldn't quite connect through the traditional systems, either because of a language barrier or of a lack of credentials or something like that. But again, all of CWJ's staff and lots of volunteers came to the place that was most needed and helped out hundreds and hundreds of families. It could be thousands for all I know, but lots and lots of people.
Kent, it might be interesting if we if unless someone has a question right now, it might be interesting for people to hear from Masahar, who had been director of CWJ and has now started a new organization.
Yeah, no, that's a good point, Mazahir. We visited with her a couple of weeks ago, knows CWJ intimately. Yeah, Mazahir, what is your next endeavor?
Oh, that you want me to talk about the Immigrants Welcome Network?
That'd be
That's
fine. Yes, thank
okay.
you.
Yeah. First, this is amazing from Yulisia, and Yulisia, she started with me as a guest volunteer, and after that, I call her and ask her to apply for this, but because really she was passionate about that, and I know she always also talk about the Catholic teaching and how that really. Importance for using it to do justice in the community. So I thought she would be really great, and I think the way that she connected everything was amazing. So, like, this is the first person I see how she connect the work and the Catholic teaching together in one beautiful piece, which is amazing. Yeah, Immigrant Welcome Network of Johnson County. To be honest, I think this is also come out of like CWJ's member needs. When I was there, the people come sometime to the center because they think we can do everything in the world at the Center for Worker Justice, because it is a, you know, like really safe hub for immigrants to come and gather and talk about their problem and their issues. That's why when the people be come to the new in the country, most of the community leaders, if they saw them somewhere they are struggling, they send them to the Center for Worker Justice. And they come to us. Sometime we can, like, we try to help them all the time as much as we can. They come for work theft, we solve their food problem, we solve their housing problem, we solve everything. But we find out, like, this is repeating things. Immigrant, when they come, 7 days later, they become homeless because they came with certain amount of money. They stay in the hotel, and after that, they their money run out, and they don't know how to navigate because they are new. So I was, long time ago, I was asking our board of directors if we can do something called, like, Justice House or something like that. But it is too much on CWJ because we have a lot of goals, and important initiative that we need to focus on. And after I found out CWJ is now well situated, everybody knows CWJ, financially sense got for many grants, and especially the CCHD grant that helping, and they stand in their feet, they are not in a bad position. So I said, I will leave and start this initiative because I really think it is important too. But that never took me away from the center, by the way. I still today, I have to go there every week. So, and you know, this initiative, we have a house now, and this house is rented for a 4-bedroom. Two people can, one family can stay downstairs, another family can stay upstairs. When they come, we just like know about, we have a waiting list because we have a lot of people, they have this in the same problem, as they cannot find housing. So when they stay at the house, we help them navigate. We will register their kids in the school. We will provide temporary housing for them, you know, obtain a social security, just help them resettling, anything that you think about. Whether like connect them with the school and job opportunity to obtain social security number, to apply for benefit, to do everything that they need. And I think so far we resettled almost 6 family, and we have now one coming on Monday, and there is a caring community member. She said she have her father's house empty, and she would love to, if we have somebody in the waiting list, they can stay there. So during summer, we always going to have this house empty, and we will just, you know, help people can stay on that house as well. So now we're going to be serving 3 different family, 2 in the welcome house, and 1 family in the, you know, the new house. So yeah, that's what we do. I think this being received, it will receive from the community, and people like the idea. And we just like also start looking for fund to continue, because right now the people who donate $50 a month, they committed for 1 year until we stand in our feet. And after that, we have to look for money to continue paying for our renter house. Yeah.
Maza here's additional endeavor talks about how a community responds with a safety net. And how, when you get as involved in the community as the Center for Worker Justice has been as an example, you begin to understand where there continues to be outstanding unmet needs. So her endeavor, the Immigration Welcome Network of Johnson County, is looking at how to be able to assist folks, particularly maybe from Sudan, as they come to Iowa City. In some respects, Iowa City is unique in so much as the number of community offerings that there are. But if you're new to Iowa City on limited means, it can be a pretty daunting challenge to find affordable housing, as one example. And so the fact that the different agencies and efforts communicate as well as they do with each other, it really speaks to where we talk about our responsibility from our faith tradition to ecumenical or interreligious affairs, to be able to not be as concerned with having to own every single project and endeavor, but to work collaboratively with other people for the benefit of the goodwill of the community. So again, I'm grateful that, and when you begin to develop those relationships, then, and somebody's undertaking a new project, you'll take the time to go and visit and hear and see how the pieces fit together. So that's it. Thank you, Masahiro. Thank you, Loxi, for bringing that up as well. Dan's got a comment.
Yeah, Masahiro, you might want to put the web address for your new group in the chat so we can find out more about it. I'd invite people to go there and just look at their board of directors. What an impressive team has assembled. And I also wanted to mention that we are very fortunate that the wise voters, in this case of Iowa City, have returned Maza here to the city council. So she is now shepherding that group as well.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah, I just put it in the chat. Yeah, it's iwnyc.org.
Any other comments or questions from those that were joining us today? My last comment to you would be, you'll receive a recording and any links that we might have based on this one. And as always, if you find that there's a topic of interest, you want to let us know, we can mull it over and figure out who might be a good presenter for upcoming sessions. 2024 stands to be an interesting year. We continue to watch matters in Des Moines, in Washington, always mindful of the common good and the preferential option for the poor, which is two of the more important tenets of Catholic social teaching. If not, I will thank you very much for your attendance, and we will stay in touch. Peace and all good.
Okay, thank you, peace.